Hi, I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. My guest today on the Dr. J Show is Matt Staver of Liberty Counsel, and he's talking to us about a very important recent court ruling. A U.S. federal court just ruled that two people have the right to talk about whatever they want to talk about. What? You may say, why is this even an issue? Good question. In Otto versus City of Boca Raton, therapist Robert Otto sued the city of Boca Raton for the right to talk with clients in the privacy of his office about their feelings of sexual attraction, the impact those feelings may be having on their lives, and strategies for improving the quality of their lives. Now, why did Mr. Otto need to go to court over this, you may ask? The city of Boca Raton, at the behest of certain activist groups and professional societies, had passed an ordinance banning what they call conversion therapy or reparative therapy, or a more neutral term, sexual orientation change efforts. Well, why would a government ban private therapeutic choices? Why would an activist group want them to ban private speech? These groups are committed to the belief that sexual orientation is an innate, immutable trait. That means a person has no meaningful choice over their sexual orientation. Any effort to change any aspect of it is doomed to failure. Why would they make a claim like that? Well, if sexual orientation really is an immutable trait, then the entire anti-discrimination legal structure can be rolled into place to treat self-described sexual minorities as a legally protected class. So there's a lot at stake in believing that sexual orientation cannot change. These ideological groups go on to claim that even the attempt to change sexual orientation will be harmful. So here's the problem. Their opening premise is incorrect. It's simply not true that sexual orientation is an immutable trait. There is no gay gene. In fact, sexual orientation is not even a well-defined scientific category. Being gay is not like being black. Many African Americans know that full well. In fact, many African Americans are deeply offended by the hijacking of the moral authority of their civil rights movement. In the immortal words of my friend, Reverend Charlene Cothran, quote, "You can see that I'm black from a block away, and I can't change my skin color." But if the sexual revolutionaries can convince people that gay is like being black, then they can import American anti-discrimination law into the realm of sexual identity and behavior. The scientific fact is that there are numerous avenues into an LGBT lifestyle and identity, and there are numerous avenues out. We have among our friends here at the Dr. J Show several people who gave up their identification with the LGBT movement without any therapy at all. So that is why cities are banning certain types of therapy. They're trying to prop up an untrue belief that happens to be useful to politically powerful groups. If this ban were left in place, therapists like Robert Otto and his colleagues would be unable to provide help to people who come to them seeking an alternative to the politically popular view. And that is why the U.S. Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit was called upon to rule on the question of whether this particular form of professional speech could be banned. And that is why we're grateful that the court ruled as they did. Listen now to my interview with Mr. Matt Staver of Liberty Counsel, who represented Robert Otto in this important case.
Joyful, joyful, Lord, be adored thee, God of glory, Lord of God.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute, and my guest today on this edition of the Dr. J Show is Mr. Matt Staver, who is with Liberty Counsel and who was the attorney who won this case, Otto versus City of Boca Raton. Matt, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Well, great. Listen, this court case just put a spring in my step, I'll tell you. I was very happy to see this result. Tell people a little bit about what the court case was really all about.
Well, the essence of it, and I can go into a little more history about how it got to this point, is whether or not a client, in this case a minor, can go to a counselor and get the counseling of his or her own choice. In every area of counseling, clients, whether they're minors or otherwise, They have the right of self-determination. They have a right to choose the counselor and the direction and how they want to manage the stresses that they're experiencing. For example, and best way to analyze this is counselors are like a GPS. Just like you get into your vehicle, the GPS doesn't predetermine your direction. You set the direction, and the GPS helps you reach that destination, helps you to navigate all the different roads to get to your final destination, and you're the one ultimately in control. Counselors are like that. They're like a GPS. The client comes in, they listen to the client, they have stresses, they want to resolve those stresses in a certain way. The counselor helps that client navigate to get to that objective. That's the essence of counseling. It's always been that way. That's why we have client confidentiality. But in this particular area, where someone experiences unwanted same-sex attractions, romantic attractions, behaviors that are unwanted, or gender conflicts. For example, someone is male and they're having difficulty identifying with their birth sex. They're going through certain areas of their time of life where they're struggling. They want to come into a counselor and they want to overcome those. They don't consider themselves gay or lesbian. They want to overcome those unwanted attractions, those unwanted behaviors, and those gender conflicts. Where these laws are, that client cannot get that kind of counsel. In fact, the counselor has to override the client's right of self-determination and cannot help that client reach the objective. And that's what these laws are all about. They are a political LGBT propaganda that wants to literally keep people in the context of their struggles. Now, these same counselors can give counsel to someone to say, you ought to take puberty blockers, very dangerous kinds of medication that have long-term consequences. You can take hormones of the opposite sex, and that person can even counsel you to remove healthy body parts, breast and other genitalia. But when that person wants to not go down that road, or having gone down that road, wants to now be comfortable with the original birth sex, these laws say counselors can't do it. And if they even provide such counsel, it's unethical treatment and they would lose their license.
So these are called bans on reparative therapy or bans on conversion therapy. There's some dispute about the terminology. It seems like the most neutral terminology is sexual orientation change efforts. And the court even says that everybody seems to accept that as a term. But what are the constitutional issues that these bans present, Matt?
Well, yeah, and regarding the language, the counselors never use reparative therapy and they don't use conversion therapy.
Right.
But all these laws use that as a political term.
Right.
Like, you're converting somebody and that the counselor is predetermining the objective, which the counselor
right.
can never do. But the
right.
real issue here is the First Amendment. Not only content-based restrictions, regulating an entire subject matter of same-sex attractions, and in this case, viewpoint, allowing certain viewpoints on that subject matter. You can affirm people. You can encourage them to go through plastic surgery and hormones. You can encourage them to override their religious value system to accept things that they don't want, namely unwanted same-sex attractions. But you cannot counsel on the other side of that coin, the other viewpoint. And so that's really where this case came down, in that it says it's both content-based, but it's also viewpoint-based.
And
viewpoint,
yes, and is even worse. That was very strongly articulated by the within the opinion itself. This isn't even a close call.
No.
This is clearly content-based, viewpoint-based. Some viewpoints are more equal than others.
Exactly. They said, in order to determine, this is what we've argued from the very beginning, how and when these particular laws apply, it depends upon the subject matter.
Right.
And so the subject matter of same-sex attractions kicks in the law, and then your viewpoint on that subject matter is either allowing you to speak or banning you from speaking on that particular viewpoint. But you can't, in this case, talk about the viewpoint of change, even when the client desperately wants change. And, the tragedy of this is we've worked with people, not only counselors, but parents and young people who have gone through these unwanted times of their growing up years of same-sex attractions for various different reasons that they encounter. And as a result of that, their self-esteem has gone down. Their peer relationships have been deteriorated. The relationships with their parents have deteriorated. And for some of them, they've even considered ending their lives. And when they ultimately reveal this to their parents and the parents find a licensed professional counselor and helps them, now these laws come in and says, you can't get that anymore. In fact, we're going to force the counselor either remain silent when you ask for that direction or go the opposite 180 degrees.
That's right. So now I want to get into this court ruling was great. And weren't you also involved in Robert Vazo's case as well in another city within Florida? That was a similar kind of case, wasn't it? Or were there differences?
Yes, in fact, I have that argument coming up at the same 11th Circuit Court of Appeals out of Tampa, Florida. They issued a similar law, and that's coming up December 15th. But we actually now are filing, we've already done so, the Atty case, because the Atty case comes from the same exact Court of Appeals,
right,
and it's already disposed of the issue. So likely that oral argument won't happen, and all of these particular laws in all three states, Florida, Georgia, and Alabama, are going to be unconstitutional under this mandatory precedent for those three states. For the other states, it's going to have very strong opinions and precedent. And so we are in other states challenging these laws. We're going to be in more states. We actually filed the very first challenge to this change counsel ban in California. It came about in 2012, 2013. And it went to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. And the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals abandoned a previous decision involving doctors being prohibited from talking about medicinal uses of marijuana. They were banned by state law at the time. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals said, that's content-based restriction. You can't do that to doctors. Fairly easy application to this, same thing. But because of the political difference, the Court of Appeals upheld it.
Mm-hmm.
It was the first case.
And so in 2012, was that still the old Stephen Reinhart days of the Ninth Circuit?
Exactly.
Okay. I only got involved in the courts because of Proposition 8. And so therefore, Stephen Reinhart is, I know him well. Let's put it that way. I know his way of doing things.
And the amazing thing is he always appeared on these marriage cases, LGBT cases, or abortion cases. Even though it's supposed to be a random assignment,
right,
all of a sudden, he's always there. And so something, I think, unusual, nefarious was going on, but he's not there anymore, and he has been replaced by a President Trump's nominee.
Yes, yes. Now, I wanted to get to that, to the significance of these of the Trump judges, because I have talked to your other attorneys, one of the attorneys in David Daleiden's case, and over the course of that case, he has seen many prejudicial rulings, what I, as a layperson, would describe as a prejudicial ruling from the bench, governing what can be presented as evidence, what experts you can present, basically determining the course of the case just with these, just arbitrary rules. Did you see any of that in this particular case, or is it more even-handed now, or what kind? Talk to us about that, because when I heard that, the first time I started hearing that, I was really shocked, and I know our listeners are shocked too, but it's important for the American public to realize how much authority sometimes these judges exercise in these cases. It turns out to be dispositive.
It's unbelievable. We actually represent Sandra Merritt, and the other attorneys represent David Daleiden in that case, so we know exactly what you're talking about. In fact, we went through a multi-week civil trial. We asked for this judge to be recused originally. He refused to do it because of his connection with Planned Parenthood. We knew it was going to be a biased.
Exactly. Woman. That one was shocking. It was unbelievable. His wife badmouthed them on Facebook.
Absolutely.
It was crazy.
And he's part of a group that actually leases space to a Planned Parenthood clinic. But he wouldn't recuse, and the Ninth Circuit wouldn't take him off the bench. So we went through this multi-week trial. It was just a dog and pony show. He wouldn't allow us to show the videos, even though the whole issue was about videos. And then when it came down to the instruction of the jury, he told them how they should rule. I mean, it was absolutely a farce.
Right.
But that is the kind of thing that we see with judges who are ideologues and don't follow the rule of law. And we see it primarily in the moral kinds of cases, mm-hmm. LGBT and abortion. In those areas of law, the rule of law gets thrown out for these ideologues that are not constitutionalist or originalist, that are not going to be committed to the original intent. The judges that President Donald Trump have appointed, 227 now have been confirmed, have been a huge change in this federal court system. Three Supreme Court justices. And they make a world of difference because they're going to be committed. He's choosing judges who are going to follow the Constitution and the original language and intent and the statutes. Now, right. They're not all perfect, obviously. We're humans. We make mistakes. But I can tell you there's a world of difference. He has appointed better judges than anybody from Reagan on.
Is that so?
There is no comparison. Wow. Reagan gave us Sandra Day O'Connor, and he also gave us Justice Anthony Kennedy, both pro-abortion justices. Mm-hmm. And George H. Bush gave us David Souter, pro-abortion. And so, you know, you go down the line. But President Trump has been different. And so here on this particular panel, it was a 2-1 decision. And it's really interesting because the two Trump appointees were the majority, and the one Obama appointee was the dissent. In this case, take a look at Amy Coney Barrett. What's the difference that she's already made at the Supreme Court? Well, just before Thanksgiving, you have a 5-4 ruling upholding the First Amendment against these draconian restrictions on places of worship.
Yep.
And that
yep.
is all the difference because we have the fifth judge on there now who's following the rule of law.
That's
so
right.
It's a huge difference. I can't even begin to underscore the magnitude of going before a judge and having the law and be able to argue the law and they understand the law and you get a ruling based upon the law.
And that they're not predetermining the outcome by
exactly.
some of these maneuvers prior to the case itself. And
that's
the interesting thing about the religious liberty, the freedom to worship, all of that, to me, when you look at Andrew Cuomo and his conduct towards both the Catholic Church and towards the Orthodox Jews, he's awful. He is awful to the Orthodox Jews. And one can't help but think that the sexual issues and the religious issues are related because these are the religious organizations who are saying, listen, guys, you don't get to do whatever you feel like. You know, there's a higher law here, and they just don't want to hear that. You know, the sexual revolutionaries do not want to hear anybody telling them you don't get to do what you can get away with.
Well, we have 7 cases in litigation regarding churches. We represent about 2,000 plus pastors in 44 states that are not in litigation, but we're working with them, have been working with them. Our case of Harvest Rock Church and Harvest International Ministries, total about 170 churches, is before the U.S. Supreme Court now. 99.1% of Californians have a no worship zone. 99.1%. If
what?
You have one person in a church, one person in a church to worship,
yeah,
that is criminal up to a year in prison and $1,000 fine. And
so that's the whole state of California? I thought they were just
99.1% is in what's called Tier 1 or the so-called purple zone, and that's zero worship.
Right.
Get this. You can't even have a Bible study or worship in your home with someone who doesn't live there. A priest, a pastor, cannot go to a person's home and anoint them in
wow.
their home or apartment. Wow. That is a criminal act in California. So here's the connection. Every single one of these cases that we're litigating with the worst restrictions on churches have the connection that you just recognized. First, they're of the same political party. They're all Democrats. But more important, even than that, they're very radical pro-abortion, very
right.
radical pro-abortion. They're also very much pro-LGBT. And if they're not going to respect your life, they're not going to respect your liberty either. And that's why we see this consistent analogy between not respecting life, not respecting your religious freedom.
Right, right. There's another issue in this particular case, in the Otto case, that really jumped out at me because, as you probably know, my background is in social science, not law. And it's always bugged me how many times we go into court and people just accept the claim
yeah.
that same-sex attraction is an immutable trait. And in this case, it's more than it's an immutable trait. It's even attempting to change will be harmful. Yeah, and that's the whole premise of the therapy ban, is that even trying to change any aspect of this is going to be harmful. And what I really liked about these judges is that they actually looked at the evidence. And they looked at the evidence and they said, yeah, this is not evidence. This is a bunch of assertions strung together. So tell us, did you make a big point of that? Did you push the evidence on them? Yeah, tell us about that, Matt.
We did. Well, we just went into, not only did we have experts, but we also had a lot of information that we dedicated in the introduction of our brief to the APA task force itself, its report. Mm-hmm. And so we pulled directly from that report, and over and over and over again, they make the same statements. And that is that there's evidence of benefit. You need to help people align their religious values with their conflicts, and it's the client's choice as to how those should be redressed and aligned. Informed consent, client autonomy, and there's no evidence, by the way, of there's no research really on minors, and there's no research, zero, on these gender conflicts, so-called transgenderism with regards to minors. And so we just went over and over and over again using the APA's task force words itself to show there's no basis for them to just simply ban this. There's even calls for additional research because there's a dearth of information out there. And if you're asking for additional research, then you're not saying we need to ban it. They're saying
right.
we just don't know.
Right. Right,
and so
right.
we have made those arguments from the beginning. But, you know, like when I was arguing in the district court in California in the very first case out there, the judge kept saying, judge couldn't figure out what happens in a counseling room. And I would say, they talk. And she,
what?
She that's what they do. They talk. The client talks, shares their issues, their conflicts, their desires. The counselor listens, and they communicate. It's just all speech. She couldn't get the idea that that's all that happened in the counseling room. She must have thought this preconceived idea that they have some torture machines
right.
in the counseling
right.
room. No, that's what counseling's all about. They just talk. They talk
right.
with one another. And she still never really grasped that because I think she had a predetermined result and obviously ruled against us in that case.
But so hold on, let's look at the, can we for a moment look at that preconceived notion, okay? Because that's out there. The idea that conversion therapy means that they take you off to a camp in the woods and a preacher tortures you until you say that you change. Are there cases like that? I mean, what we're talking about here obviously doesn't include that, but somehow the impression has been created that's what it's all about, that shock therapy or aversion therapy or, you know, I don't even know what all, but what's the evidence about that? Is that going on somewhere? Is that happening someplace?
Not that we are aware. In fact, all of the counselors that we represent, and we also represent large counseling associations as well, none of the counselors engage in any kind of shock therapy. They don't put rubber bands on your wrist and snap you. They don't do waterboarding. They don't do those kinds of things. They just sit in a room and they talk.
Right.
That's all they do is they talk, and they talk through the issues to help. It's like a GPS. It talks to you. You put in the goal, it talks to you. It doesn't slap you on the face when you make a wrong turn. It just says, no, we got to redirect you now. You want to get over here because this is where you want to go. That's what counselors do as well.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Now, what you'll ultimately do is you'll get some of these LGBT groups, and they inevitably have some anecdotal statement that you don't know where it came from. You don't know who it was. You don't know how long ago it was. It has nothing to do with our case. And they'll throw that in and say, this is what counseling people who have these unwanted same-sex attractions does. And we'll say, no, that's not what we do. And our affidavits, our experts will explain what takes place in a counseling session to try to make sure that these judges understand the process.
And so really that's a part of the public relations ploy to
exactly.
change the subject. You know, the subject is a person who does not want the feelings that they're having. Their feelings and behaviors are presenting problems in living. They want help with those problems in living. And for some strange reason, the gay lobby doesn't want them to have that help.
They don't
Oddly enough.
They don't want them to have that choice. It's just like in, you know, the abortion context, they don't want women to even know or be informed about the procedure. Same thing here. They don't even want them to know that there's an option. In fact, they not only don't want them to know there's an option, they want them to know there is no option.
That's right. That's right.
They should go the direction they want to go.
And there are a number of parallels between the attack on the crisis pregnancy centers and the attack on therapy bans or talk therapy to assist people with unwanted same-sex attraction. In both cases, there are people who are saying, you know, this grand narrative doesn't seem to apply to me. I want to do something else.
Right.
And Zoom, in come the ideologues to say, no, it'll be fine. It'll be fine. Those people, they're crazy. They're going to lie to you. They're going to shock you. They're going to stick you with rubber bands or, you know, whatever it is that they're saying about people. Yeah. And what do you think is the connection here between these
Well, I think there's a physical connection. I think there's also a spiritual connection, and that is human sexuality. You know, God created male and female in His image. Bringing those two together to join in marriage, and from that union to be able to procreate another human being who also is made in the very image of God and infused with human dignity because of God's creation. It's an amazing gift that God has blessed humans with, to be able to literally procreate another human being in the image of God and to care and nurture that individual.
Yeah.
And so abortion attacks that very source. It is a direct attack on God when you ultimately destroy that innocent, helpless individual in the womb, and you ultimately destroy that family unit, particularly the mother, but also the father as well.
Right.
And then same-sex marriage, or I should say same-sex activity, abortion is really human sexuality without the consequence of procreation.
Right.
Same-sex activity is human sexuality without the possibility of procreation. And it takes what God designs as good and literally perverts it 180 degrees to the opposite. Instead of creating life, it's destroying life. Instead of bringing unity and productivity, it ultimately does exactly the opposite. So abortion and the whole LGBT, human sexuality, have a very significant link with one another. Yeah.
Yes, I think that's true. And here at the Ruth Institute, we talk about this as it's one giant issue. You know, the whole sexual revolution is one giant issue, and you've identified some of the parts of it. But I would like to get back just for a moment to the evidence that you guys presented. You looked at the APA's brief. The American Psychological Association filed a brief saying how harmful this kind of practice is, but then admitting that they didn't really have evidence for it. And so you got the court to actually look at that and take that seriously. So what's at stake? If you could prove that people could change their sexual orientation and that it was not harmful to try, if you could prove that that was really, that was a possible thing, what further implication would that have for the LGBT movement and their legal strategies and so on? Why are they so intent on that?
Well, originally, they wanted to ride the train of the civil rights of mutable skin color and race. And obviously, you're born of a certain race, and you can't change that. And so you shouldn't be punished because of that, and should all be protected because we're individuals made in the image of God. So they originally wanted to ride that, and they still do. But they jump off that train periodically because they also want to say, well, no, it's as malleable as an ever-changing river, and you have this spectrum. But the spectrum never goes to heterosexuality. It only goes one way, against heterosexuality, never in their worldview, to heterosexuality or consistent with heterosexuality. So they ride that train both ways. And so what they'll say is, in this situation, well, you're denying the very person that this individual is. They're born that way. They want to use that argument that they're born that way, and now you're trying to change something that is immutable and that causes harm. Yet, you know, for example, in Tampa, the Vaso case, Robert Vaso case that we have there, the city had certain experts, and during our depositions, we deposed them and we asked them a lot of questions on cross-examination. The city's experts' responses made it into the actual opinion, and it's a beautiful three-page bullet point of exactly what we're talking about, that people have changed, that there's no research that shows harm, that there is actually other information that is beneficial, and that, you know, the issue of having a young child, an adolescent, for example, or even a teenager, experiencing unwanted gender conflicts, that even with no counseling intervention, 85% or more of those individuals naturally resolve those unwanted conflicts so that they are very comfortable with their birth sex. And therefore, now if you start counseling somebody who's going through that period of uncertainty, yet they're going to be one of the 85 plus percent people that naturally resolve the conflicts without counseling. And now you lock them in to a situation to say, you know, you're never going to resolve this. You just need to be comfortable that you identify as something opposite than what you're born with. And consequently, let's give you puberty blockers. Let's give you later on hormone treatment. And then let's do some invasive plastic surgery to remove healthy body parts. That is very, very harmful. And so all of that information is in there, and he does the same thing. By the way, we won that case below. Tampa appealed it, and he's also a President Trump appointee as well. So very solid opinion in that Tampa case, but also the same thing we did in the case involving Boca Raton, Florida, and Palm Beach County with the Atty case.
Yes, yes. And so another way to express what you just said is to say that the grand narrative of the LGBT movement is that you're born that way, it's an immutable trait, being gay is like being black, and right. So therefore we need to use all of the same legal strategies. That's what we get to do. So if a person shows up and said, I used to be gay, I'm not gay anymore, or however they want to express that, or a person shows up and says, I don't like this. I'm gonna do something about this. That person is a threat to the whole structure that they have.
Exactly.
And the parallel with the crisis pregnancy centers is that the grand narrative there is that abortion solves women's problems, and women never regret their abortions. It's always a happy ending. You know, if you kill the baby, it's always a happy ending. And any woman who pops up and says, you know, I really want to keep my baby, or, you know, somebody's pressuring me into this, and if somebody would help me, I wouldn't have to do this. And, you know, I actually kind of regret my abortion. Those people have all got to sit down and shut up. Exactly. Those people are a threat.
The analogy is exactly the same, you know, and Walt Heyer is an example of this. Walt Heyer, you know, was born male. He went through various kinds of issues growing up. His grandmother wanted a girl, so dressed him in dresses and would praise him. So he got praises when he would dress as a girl. He later got sexually molested by an uncle and ultimately developed gender conflicts and eventually left his wife. He was married, ultimately left, and went through different kinds of surgery, hormone treatment, was counseled only in one direction. Mm-hmm. And then after the honeymoon passed, and you have this temporary, well, I've done it now, and then it sinks in. Right. My conflicts are still here, and they're worse because I've made some irretrievable kinds of decisions that I can't go back on. I've actually removed certain healthy body parts that can't just be reattached. And then you're stuck. And when you go back to the people that gave you a directional sign, only one direction, they then think that you're a traitor and you're a threat. So you're shut off from that community.
Right.
And he ended up, you know, obviously going through counseling, a Christian, and helps people just like what he went through. And he's been happily married now for a number of years. But that's the kind of thing. A Walt Heyer person, somebody who has gone through that process and they're comfortable with how God made them as a male in his case, is a threat to that narrative.
That's right. That's exactly right. And so in a sense, that's what's really at stake. That's in these cases, in addition to the First Amendment and all the other issues we've talked about, the issue also at stake is it really true that people are born that way? Yeah. And since that's not true, that's a belief that has to be propped up all the time. and dissent has to be squashed all the time. And there always will be dissent, because there always are going to be people who are going to say, what just happened? You know, this doesn't work for me. I want to be respectful of your time, Matt. Are there any other points about this case or other cases that you have coming up that you would like to share with our followers?
Well, I think, you know, going beyond the First Amendment and the evidence in the case, just to kind of circle back to the real people involved, we're talking about real people and we're talking about life and death. And, you know, from the first loss that we had at the Court of Appeals in California, and then the second one that we had in New Jersey, and then these cases, then these laws started proliferating around the country. And circling back to your point, what ultimately was a major change was the crisis pregnancy center cases out of California. And that was the 2018 case. There was several cases. We represented some of those crisis pregnancy centers at the U.S. Supreme Court. And the argument in that case was, by California, we can force these crisis pregnancy centers to promote abortion because they're licensed, and licensed professionals don't have the same level of speech protections, i.e., let's look at what we just did, the Ninth Circuit, in the counseling session. And so that was their argument. Just like in counselors, licensed pregnancy centers.
Oh, I see.
They don't have the same protection.
Okay.
They have to get a license. And so, yeah, they have First Amendment protection, but it's much, much less than what you and I would have in a normal situation. That was their argument. Well, the Supreme Court rejected that outright. And they also cited a case that came out of Florida with regards to doctors. Doctors being told by the Florida legislature that they needed to inquire from their patients about whether they had any firearms at home. Doctors objected to that. They didn't want to be forced to ask certain questions. And so the 11th Circuit went the right way, struck that down as a violation of free speech. The 9th Circuit and the 3rd Circuit with Pickup and King, the counseling cases, went the wrong way, and they created the speech category called professional speech. And the Supreme Court said there is no such category. Mm-hmm. And they abrogated those decisions. And from that moment
This was Clarence Thomas, wasn't it?
Yes, that's right.
Who said professional speech. Now, say that again for us, because it's a little bit technical.
There is no such category as professional speech. In fact, right. If there were, all you would have to do if you wanted to restrict somebody's speech is require them to get a license.
Right.
Whatever it is.
Right.
Truck drivers have licenses. So can you restrict their speech? And so they rejected it outright. And at that point in time, I said, it's just a matter of not if, but when we get one of these cases back to the Supreme Court, and we'll strike these down across the country. And this is the first Court of Appeals decision since that 2018 NIFLA crisis pregnancy center decision.
Beautiful. Beautiful. That's great. Because I remember when that happened and one of my former law students pointed it out and I went, whoa, that's really interesting.
It was a bonus. Not only did we win in the crisis pregnancy center cases, but we got the bonus on these counseling cases
for
free speech for the same reason. And so really during that time, up until this amazing decision, you know, my thought is about these counselors, in particular, the people. Because I've seen people that have been helped immensely. And now these laws come in and they're politically motivated and they're designed to do exactly what we've talked about, stop the narrative of change,
right.
That change is not possible in their worldview. And they don't like to accept the fact that change is possible.
Right.
And yet there's real people that struggle with this, and it's literally life and death situations for many of them, because you're dooming them to a direction that they don't want to be in. And it can be very frustrating.
Right.
And it's life and death for some people. So seeing the fact that people can get real help, that has always been a real burden to me. And this is the beginning, as I said, in the statement, press statement, when this came out, this is the beginning of the end of these bans on change counsel. And we're going to strike them down all over the country.
Matt Staver, that's a great place to end our conversation. Thank you so much for your work. Where can people get in touch with you guys and keep up with what you're doing? Because I know some of our people are just going to be so excited to hear about this.
Well, thank you. You can go to our website, lc.org, just two letters, lc.org. Lc.org is the place to go.
Liberty Counsel, lc.org. Beautiful. Matt Staver, thank you so much for being my guest on this episode of the Dr. J Show.
Thank you. My pleasure.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.